All right. Hello and welcome to Backstage with Gig Performer. I'm so happy to have you guys here. As you're popping in, shoot us a hello. Let us know where you are tuning in from. Welcome, welcome. And today we are really excited because we are kicking off a brand new series called the Genre Series, where we're going to explore pro musicians who are using Gig Performer across lots of different genres of music. And we've been spending a lot of time really talking about the ins and outs of how the software works. What are the things you need to know in order to use Gig Performer effectively? And so we're moving into the series now as a way to really look at what that means for people who are doing different types of music, because from cover bands to improv bands to whatever it is that you're playing, the way you're going to use Gig Performer is going to shift a little bit to meet those specific needs. But if we haven't met before, my name is Brett Pontecorvo. You might know me from Live Keyboardist or from Backstage if you've been here from a while. Most weeks we are joined by Naboja and David, our co-founders of Gig Performer. And as you can see, David and Naboja are musicians, and David is actually not with us today because he is at rehearsal for a show that he's got going on. We've got some amazing people coming on the show. I want to give you guys a bit of a preview of some of the people who are coming up. Today we've got Bruce Moore. You guys are just going to be blown away by what he's doing with Gig Performer. It is unbelievable and very cool and really specific to what he's doing with his cover band. In 2 weeks, we've got Igor Paspalj coming on, who does hard rock and neoclassical. That's what he said he does. It's very hard to define his music, but what he does is beautiful and amazing. Robert Martin, if you haven't heard of him, go to his website and just read what he does. It was like, how do I get what Robert Martin has done on one line and a graphic? Very hard. And then we've got Joel Brazzi coming at the very, very end. There are a couple more people who I'm hammering down a date with, but these are the things that you can look forward to. But today we are focusing on Bruce Moore, who is a guitarist for the Fringe Benefit band. He's been using Gig Performer for quite a while, and he's actually not just a guitar player. He is playing MIDI guitar and also regular guitar and also singing. So he's jack of all trades a little bit here. He's doing some really cool things with MIDI. He's going to explain all this to us. And so we're going to bring him on. I'm going to bring Bruce in. We're going to have a chat, and then we'll go from there. Bruce, welcome.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Yes, thanks so much for being here. Bruce, you were explaining to me a little bit earlier what you do, but for those who haven't heard about the Fringe Benefit Band, can you just give us like a brief background? Tell us what you like. What do you do with the Fringe Benefit Band? Ooh, how long have you been playing and all that good stuff?
Okay, great. So yeah, I've been playing way too long. I don't want to disclose any numbers here, you know. I'm trying to be, sometimes we have younger audiences and my age is not cool. But yeah, we play cover songs for people that dance. I mean, basically we're playing in bars to sell alcohol. I mean, nobody's going to eat for 4 hours, but they will drink for 4 hours and they will dance and they will have a great time. So we want to play songs that people recognize. And, you know, one of the key things with that is having the right sounds, which Gig Performer's given me lots of control over these sounds. And I'm, you know, I'm using it to switch sounds often while I'm singing. You know, we're playing some Motown, some Stevie Wonder, and some Aretha Franklin is pretty popular right now because of the new Respect movie that came out. And then we play 80s through today. I think the newest song we're playing right now is Watermelon Sugar by Harry Styles. That's fairly recent. Of course, it's been kind of a, you know, with the COVID, you know, it's hard to keep your pulse on what's happening in the clubs when they're closed or went out of. Actually, we had a tough time with that. We had regular venues stop having bands or just fold all together. Including some great clubs, but anyway, what we're doing is we're entertaining people. We have had some success with original music. We don't play it in our shows, They want to hear, you know, familiar songs. And depending on age group, we like to have enough material where we could, you know, go back and forth. Now, if you're playing, sometimes we'll play a private event like a wedding and you have a lot of age groups. So we mix it up, you know, and you'll hear stuff from all eras, but it's all pop. There's no country. There's maybe some funky pop and there's some rock, you know, kind of pop. No metal, no country. And that's pretty much what we're doing.
So I was looking through your website and the page that has your list of songs, it's huge. Do you know, like, off the top of your head, like, what is your total? Like, how many songs does your band know? Obviously you don't play them every time, but like, your total set?
So those are songs that we, you know, choose from for shows. Sometimes I'll put some extras in there. The ones that are in regular rotation, vary, you know. I'd say probably we have 60 songs in regular rotation right now. You know, typically we're playing a set for an hour. You know, look, after, here's one of the things with a cover band. After, say, 11:30, if you take a break, everybody goes home and alcohol sales go, you know, really down. So what we're doing there is we're not breaking after 11:30. So we'll just play an hour and a half if that's what it takes, you know. So
And Bruce, when you go to play these shows, roughly how much time do you have to actually set up? Like, you guys get in at what time, start playing at what time? Like, what happens once you get there? How much time do you have?
So if we're in control of that, we'll get there 2 hours in advance. For a new venue, and even if it's not a new venue sometimes. And and that allows enough time for setup and sound check, and then maybe 45 minutes before the audience comes in. We can set up in 45 minutes if we have to, and we have had to, because if you play shows with other bands, they never allow enough time between, you know, shows, so.
Yep, absolutely. So part of having an efficient setup is kind of having a process. And Bruce, I know you're going to show us, you know, the instrument side of things, but you sent us this video that's really detailed about the setup portion. So I'm going to roll this video and then we're going to answer some questions. But actually, we've got some people here I want to welcome. So Bob Miller, thank you so much for being here from Winnipeg. We've got The Brush Within. Hello from Louisville. Nemanja, this is our wonderful gig performer team member and also the manual writer, doing all sorts of awesome stuff with our blog. Thank you guys, as always, so much for being here. We are going to roll this video and then we'll chat about it. Here goes.
This is my rack that I use with my cover band, the Fringe Benefits. You can see the computer at the top there. We've got gig performer on the screen. And then This is a relatively small rack. It's got a audio interface at the top, and then some wireless, some in-ear transmitters, a power strip, mic splitters to go to front of hall, and then an MR18 mixer that we use for main sometimes, and then always for in-ear monitors. Here's a little closer view of the equipment in the rack. I've got a light in the rack that's obstructing some of the Focusrite 20i18 or 18i20, whatever it is. It's the third generation unit that we're using to get the natural guitar signal in to the computer, as well as we do vocal processing in the computer. So we got five vocal mics and the natural guitar sound going in, and then all that coming out, plus the synth sounds. Immediately below that, you'll see the little AKG unit is the receiver for wireless natural guitar sounds. On the far left is a little charger for phones and 5-volt for the iPads, charging those things. On the right is a USB hub that has the receiver for the Fishman triple play, as well as for the Livid guitar wing. And then below that are the two transmitters for in-ear. And then below that, you'll see on the left is the Shure GLX-D4, is a wireless microphone that Lead Vocalist uses. And then there's a modem, a router next to that for wireless Wi-Fi, and then the power supply. And let me just, I'll tilt this a little bit. You can see closer up on these mic splitters. So you notice they're all color-coded and labeled. This really helps with setup. I mean, if you open a box and you're looking for the cable that says kick, it's a lot harder to find than one that's red. So we did a lot of color coding with regard to setup as well. And then on here, everything plugs in when we go and sound supplied. The technician will run into here, and then I'll come out of there with a stake that plugs into their system, so they get the original sound, well, the processed vocals in the guitar synth, but then they get to mix with their equipment for the front of hall, and then down below that, everything is split off into this Midas MR80 or MR18 mixer that we're using, so each person on their phone can dial in the monitor mix that they want. Our band uses in-ear monitors, no guitar amps, no floor monitors. There's no speakers on stage. We are using acoustic drums, and so that's pretty much the only sound that's emanating from the stage. Here's the back of the rack where you can see a lot of the wiring. You notice I'm using color-coded cables, so if something goes wrong, it's easy to trace. And then also you'll notice at the back there's a Obey 40 light controller from Chauvet. I'm sending MIDI to that from Gig Performer to change chases and light scenes. And then you're also seeing a lot of the mic splitters there where there's a lot of outlets that go to front hall and the power connections. Also have some lighting in there, the power supply for the computers in there. So basically when I get to a gig, I'm plugging this in, and all the connections for the computer are already there. So they just unfold from the back of the rack. So here's my main stage guitar. It's about a 1972 Tele Neck that's mounted on about a 1972 Strat body. And you'll notice in the lower part of the pick guard all these buttons. That's part of the Livid guitar wing. There's actually a Livid guitar wing under there. Rather than clamping it on, I gave a more natural appearance by having a custom pick guard made to cover it up. And then I have the same pickup configuration as the Fender Triple Play Strat, which I also have one of those, but this guitar has special meaning to me, and I wanted to make it a Fishman Triple Play too. So I actually had to buy a Godin and have the guts removed and implanted in this to get that. You'll see down at the bottom here, there's a couple receivers. There's the in-ear wireless and the guitar transmitter. So we've got those two going. We got the Bluetooth coming out of the triple play and the Bluetooth coming out of the Livid guitar wing. So I'm using a lot of channels in the 2.4 gigahertz band, so I don't like anybody else using that. And I have to remember to turn the Bluetooth off on my computers and my phone in order to keep from getting stuck notes on the triple play. And it's pretty much been solved now. We're doing well with it. So the buttons on the guitar, what I use the most is just to change patches, or actually song parts in Gig Performer. I'm using the arrows to go back a song part and then to skip a song. And then some of the other buttons are for a boost, the Leslie sound or rotary sound on the organ patch. One of them I do use as kind of a drum pad to trigger a pew sound for the No Doubt song, Hella Good. And then the little small buttons along there I'm using to change guitar patches if I need to. Normally I don't. I just go from song part, and it's all programmed in the set list and Gig Performer. But if I need to change it manually, I can. One of the buttons does blackout on the lights. One of them triggers a file player within Gig Performer, and one of them is the panic button. So it's really used primarily just for control. Just the one button I'm using is kind of a drum pad, if you will.
So Bruce, that's a pretty well-designed setup, right? You built that on purpose so that when things go wrong, you don't have to worry. Would you say that's true?
Yeah, when you get stuff that's so complicated, you got to have backups and you know, alternative plans. So if the whole freaking thing blows up, you know, I could literally come out of the computer. I've got a cable to go come out of the earphone jack into an XLR.
Yep.
I've never had to use that, but some bad things have happened before.
Yeah. No, absolutely. So if anybody has any questions about any of the like hardware setup that you want to ask Bruce, feel free to pop those in the comments. But Bruce, would you be willing to show us the gig performer side, the part that interfaces with you know, the hardware you just showed us?
Sure. I'm glad to show how I'm using Gig Performer. But, you know, on the hardware thing is one other thing I like to mention, and that is no foot pedals. So I'm playing as many sounds as anybody, and I'm controlling the lights, and I have no foot pedals. It's all done right there on the guitar with that limited wing controller. So what's great about that is we do a little bit of choreography, so I can be anywhere on the stage and make stuff happen. So,
you like switched to the guitar wing, like, or were you at one point using a foot pedal to control Gig Performer, or Gig Performer wing happened at the same time?
When I started using a guitar synth, it was a Roland GR33, and I'm doing a little dance all the way through the song, hitting all those pedals as I'm changing patches and having to remember, you know, what bank and what number it was. I don't have to do that with Gig Performer because of the set list thing. And and that is just revolutionized it for me. I was still choosing patches when I was using the Fishman triple play software. I still had to know what patch it was going because I only hold 10. And then you had to load another 10. Well, you can't do that during a set. You got to do that on a break. So you have to kind of narrow it down and do it. With Gig Performer, you know, it's a different either Rackspace or it's a different song part, all the way through the whole night, and I just advance. So I'll bring up Gig Performer here. I got to share my screen, right?
Oh, you're shared. Your screen is live. It's there.
Okay. All right. Great. So so here's pretty much all my Rackspaces look like this.
Okay.
And I've got a little signal level meter over here that's not really a signal. It really just bounces up and down according to the MIDI. So I could, you know, see that it's going into the computer. Then the gain control is really just the overall volume of the patch. This particular one has a parametric equalizer. There's a lot of high end on this on one of the sounds, and I want to be able to adjust it on variations if I needed to. The balance knob here. I'm sorry, Brett. Is this what you wanted to hear?
Yes, all of this. Yes. Well, yeah, I want it definitely the inner workings of what you're doing. Actually, we have a question coming in here that I think will be a quick answer. Do you use the learn function for the guitar wing to assign CCs and Gig Performer? I assume. I don't know. Well, I guess you can answer. What do you do for that?
Yes, I do. However, I had some problems doing that because not so much with the guitar wing, but with the Fishman triple play, it sends out a bunch of MIDI signals like, blah, you know, and so you can't pick which one you want a lot. Mm-hmm. So actually, I don't know how you get it in there without learning it, but what I wound up doing was using a separate set of software to put it into MIDI code that I wanted it to respond to. So yes, I do use the learn function.
Yeah. And there actually is a function. Let me see here. There actually is a function in Gig Performer that allows you to just manually tell it what it should be mapped to. But anyway, that we could do a little demo of that at some point. But I didn't want to cut you off. Do you want to keep touring us through here? I'm going to full screen this. So I guess you were at the balance knob.
Yeah, the balance knob to the left is synth sounds. To the right is natural guitar sounds.
Okay.
And then down below here, there's Juliana is our lead vocalist. There's some songs and some song parts that we use a doubler on her voice. So, excuse me.
Oh, you're fine.
Okay, and then we used to do some songs that had a vocoder sound, like a robot sound. Mm-hmm. So I had that in here.
Okay.
The scene is the light scene. And it's not, and actually, it used to be lighting scenes, but I changed it to chases, which is a group of scenes, and it changes between, coordinated lighting effects based on this number. So, like, number one is like bright and blue, and number two is warm and blue, and mm-hmm. number eight is nothing but drums highlight, and number nine is wide open. Things like that. So,
and so are you controlling that manually, or was that something that's you put within your song parts, or how are you actually using that knob?
It's a song part.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Gotcha. And as is the guitar patch.
Gotcha.
So, awesome. Which I don't use this guitar patch thing a lot anymore, because, I just have a separate, song part for guitar parts.
Right. Right.
And, makes then, a ton and of then, sense. Then the boost gives me a 4.5 dB boost for solos. Mm-hmm. And then when I have the guitar engaged with the bass control, I have this big light to let me so I can see it. You see, it moves gotcha. The balance control over. I really needed a good indication. And then the little rack below here, we got I'm using Waves. Real-time auto-tune on the vocals, except Juliana doesn't like it, so it's not on hers. But all the rest of us could use a little help. So we've got it. You can hardly hear it. We just have it chromatic. So, if you're really far off, it's just going to lock you into the wrong note. Hopefully, that doesn't happen very often. There are a couple songs where there's like three-part harmony behind the lead vocal, and we actually have it set to what key it is, so you can't hit a wrong note. Fergie in the Black Eyed Peas, if you've ever heard her sing without the auto-tune.
Listen, we all need a little help sometimes, you know? Hey, Bruce, we got a question coming in for you.
Okay.
Do you use a wing controller to, I'm not sure what that, maybe that's a typo. Balgut the synth?
Balance the guitar and synth. Yeah, gotcha. Yes, I have a control that switches between guitar and synth. And I used to have one that would allow me to set it for both of them to play. But I don't do that anymore because I needed the button for something else. Yeah, balance.
Gotcha.
Yeah, right.
Gotcha. That's what
it's said. So, but yeah, the balance between them is set by the song part. But yeah, we do occasionally have stuff happen off the cuff. So I can, she'll call an audible. We'll be in the middle of a set list, and boom, she wants a song that's not even on the set list.
Yeah.
So So great. Hopefully it is guitar because I can push the button and I have guitar, right? Otherwise, yes. I'm like, I'm hunting for piano for a song that has a piano so I can play this song.
I feel like I maybe cut you off with that question there. Was there more? You were talking about the auto-tune. Was there more in that rack space you wanted to show?
Well, let me go back to that and let's see what I got.
Okay.
No, that's it. I thought maybe I'd show the wiring part of it now.
Yes. Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Okay. All right. So the M1 is the guitar wing, and then the S1 is the Fishman trumpet play. So they're both going into to sample tank. The sample tank is making the sounds, and I've got this equalizer on there. And then one of these gain things is just, let's see. Yeah, that's the one. So it's I'm in 0 dB and minus 5.3 dB. So that's my boost switch.
Mm-hmm. And that's controlled on your guitar wing.
Right. So I'm hitting a button on my guitar that's making that happen.
Okay, gotcha.
So that I have that in like all my patches. And then the gain and balance, this kind of a holdover from when I was doing guitar within gig perform. But the natural guitar now, I'm actually doing it in main stage. And you'll notice over here, all these outputs I've got MIDI out going to the Scarlett 18i20, which has a MIDI out that is going into that Chauvet lighting controller. So this L1 is actually, you know, I'm sending signals through. Let's see what's in this song part here. It's not in the song part. It's in a script. So I got a script that reads that knob and then sends the appropriate MIDI code out to here. And then, gotcha. And then this MIDI out going to the triple play. So when I change song parts, I have really maybe six different modes within the hardware of the triple play. Like, for example, there's a triggered mode for piano. So mm-hmm. like when you bend the note, it's like you hit another note rather than just fading into it. We have the smooth. So like if I'm playing saxophone, I can bend the note continuously. And then there's some other variations of that.
Okay.
And so the gig performer is actually controlling the triple play. We used to go the other way, and you'll see over here in my set list or my rack spaces, these numbers, those were the program change numbers I used to use when I had to change patches on the triple play, and then it would, you know, change to the rack space in gig performer. But since we started having set lists in gig performer, it's way better to do it the other way. And so that's what's happening here. And then the back to GP is really going to main stage. So that's sending, there's a IAC driver that you make within the Apple MIDI control panel. And I'm sending it to that, and that in turn connects to the other software. And then we got the MIDI out going to the Living Guitar Wing, and that's all controlled by a script as well that lights the lights and all that. So I wrote all those scripts before Gig Performer either had or I learned how to use, the two-way communication with the hardware.
Yeah, and we were talking about this earlier, Bruce, but just, you know, I think it bears reiterating, you know, to some amount, like once you get a live setup that's working for you, there's no reason to redo it, right? Unless you're getting some delay, but you know, you wrote these scripts, they're working, it's a part of your setup, you know, and so you just follow suit with it because the point of all of it is to be making good music.
Well, that's true. Yeah.
Right? The heart behind all of it is getting on the stage and making music that people can dance to for 4 hours. So whether you're using a script or you're using something that's simpler or more complicated or whatever you're doing, if the people are dancing, it doesn't matter. Right. I mean, that's the heart behind it. So Bruce, you've been talking a lot about, you know, I've already lost the name of it. The MIDI controller that you're using to use your guitar as an instrument that triggers VSTs. Can you give us a demo of how that works or what you're doing with it? Or
yeah. Unshare my screen and go back to the. I think, I don't know. I can just play some, but you know, one of the things that's, I want to go, let me see. What are you showing on the
screen? Right now I've got your screen up, but we don't have to have it that way.
Okay.
What's the easiest way to show people how that works? Go for it.
Yeah. So one of the things in a cover band is if you can have sounds that sound like the original recording, some of them they're really key. One of them is, Bruno Mars Locked Out of Heaven. It's got this. So I'm using splits here. So without having to change patches, I can actually go. So I got all these different sounds. This is a split between strings, And then this is a split between frets. So as you go up and down the neck. So that's a lot of that's within the Fishman triple play. But as I mentioned when we were before we came online, I can determine a fret, and beyond that fret is MIDI channels 11 through 16, and below it is 1 through 6. So I've actually I've got another example of that. I want to show you people. I'm in the all songs here, but we got to go to backstage. Okay, so I made a set list because there were some things I thought you might like to see.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. That's awesome.
So I want to show you what I'm using for smooth. So for smooth, I've got. Let me go. I want to go back and see what I'm showing here.
Oh yeah, I've got you up on the screen.
Okay.
Oh, but if you
I want to slow the guitar down, then I'll switch to the screen.
Perfect.
So for smooth, you got. So this is all horns. So we got, and then. So that's piano. I don't have to switch anything. But if you come up the neck, it becomes horns there.
Wow. And so you're doing that within the triple play? Or?
Yeah, so the triple play makes it a different MIDI channel.
Yes.
The MIDI channel changes there. So now let me go to Gig Performer.
Okay.
And I'm going to go to the wiring diagram here. And you see I've got two contact instances in here. And so what I'm doing here, let's see, this is S1. I've got, looks like I got everything going in there. So here I've blocked all these.
Yep.
So these channels 7 through 16 are blocked. So it'll only pick up the appropriate channels in that particular instance of contact.
And so, Bruce, it looks like you pulled the lower end of the velocity off on those MIDI in blocks. Were you doing that to prevent accidental sound? Is that?
Oh yeah, exactly. Yeah. So okay. Sometimes I'll do that. Yeah, you're right. So like in here, I set a minimum so that if you have your finger on a string and you don't even pick it and you release it, it makes a sound. And right. I don't want a note to play just because I'm changing positions. So I had to set a minimum velocity, which I could do that within the triple play. Mm-hmm. But you know what? Depending on what you're playing, the song part. It's great to be able to vary it by song part. So by rack space. So I put it in Gig Performer to give me more flexibility.
Yep. Awesome. So that split, then you're doing, it's just, you've changed the MIDI in block to receive the correct MIDI channel. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yep. Beautiful.
So one of these horns and one of them is piano. So that's what's going on.
Amazing. And when you're doing your set list mode, you kind of had it flipped back there before. Like, can we see, like, as you move through those parts, are your light stuff changing? Like, do you do extra work?
So here it is in smooth, and I'm playing the horns and the piano. And then when it goes to, the organ part. So I don't know if you can see these knobs change, but, it was on scene 4 there. And then when I go to the organ, it goes to scene 8.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. And the benefit of this, I mean, maybe this is obvious, but I feel like it's worth pointing out. The benefit is you've built this song out, and now you open it up and the lights are correct.
Yes. Yeah.
so there's no, concern about redoing it or whatever. It's like Gig Performer just manages it. And the other thing too that I think is worth pointing out, for those of you who might have missed it, like Bruce built this set list. You can kind of see it on the screen there, that, and it says Backstage, right? It's like he took from his giant list of songs and put the songs that he wanted to maybe demo for today in its own set list. So there's a whole pool of other songs that aren't included in the Backstage set list, but this is just, you know, almost filtering down to only what he needs to see for right now, which is just nice to have for flexibility. This is very, very cool. I've got a question coming in here from Bob Miller, this is not the question. Are you using mono mode?
Yes. Yeah, you got to use mono mode. If you look in the Fishman, so you saw him about the Fishman triple play. If you look in their documentation, it has a lot of benefits that they say, you know, is in the mono mode. And then they have some functions only work in the polyphonic mode. But but yeah, I'm using the monophonic mode, and that's how. Speaking of which, let me show you what I'm doing on Sweet Caroline. Because okay. I got a lot of stuff happening on that. Okay. So there's only one song. Can you see it?
Yep. I'm going to actually make it bigger here.
Okay.
Yep.
So I just went from the low E string to the A string. So that was the fourth and third strings. So you're hearing all these different sounds. And then when you get to that part, I'm doing just above the 12, 34, 15th fret, above the 15th fret, it changes to strings. So all these sounds, the organ, the fridge horn, the horns, so all that is below that 15th fret, or and then above the 15th fret, we got all those strings you have for that part. So I'm singing while that's going on, and I don't have to change patches. So, this is.
Do you prefer thinking that way, Bruce? Like I like not changing patches as well, but as a guitar player, if you're playing in a different octave, it's very different feel than a piano player playing in a different octave. Did that take some adjusting, or how did that come to be? Like for you mentally?
So when I learned the song, I learned it in those positions, for that, so it's just, that's just how I play the song, sometimes I do have to, change the way I'm playing songs because it's easier, but you'd play it a different way.
Yep.
I thought maybe I'd show you what's going on back here.
Yeah.
You can see the MIDI channels. You got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? And 1, 2, and 3 is a horn section. And then also a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I've got a trombone solo going along with the horn section. And then the sixth string and the sixth, MIDI channel 6 is an organ. And then channels 13, 14, and 15, which is the third, fourth, and fifth strings, is a string section. But it's these channels are not implemented until above the 15th fret.
So now there was some thinking. There was some thinking that went into this.
The above the 15th fret thing is within the Fishman triple play.
Yes.
But what happens is, because on those channels, it's pretty easy to make the different sounds on the different strings. But it's this particular one, not only is it split between strings, it's split by fret as well.
Yep.
So that's
It's serious. We had a question come in, and this is a dangerous question, but I want to answer it just a little bit. So without explaining all of what you know about gig script and going down the whole rabbit hole of all of that, what is the shortest possible definition of gig performer script that you can functionally give, and maybe explain why you're using it?
Well, it's a programming language that opens up many possibilities in functionality of gig performer.
Yep.
That's
great.
That's about it.
Why did you, because you're doing some scripting for the lights. Why did you go that route? I'm assuming some of the functionality you have to, in order to get it, you have to write a script. But is that what it was, or do you have scripting background and that's how you ended up there, or how did that occur?
Well, I've got some programming background, but I didn't know, GP script, of course, but,
sure.
The documentation is designed for people that already know programming. And there was enough examples. I kind of, figured I did something simple and then I did a little bit more. And, some of the things that I've got scripted are now features of Gig Performer, but right. they didn't exist, or I didn't know how to use them at the time. Mm-hmm. So, I just did my own thing. Do you have my screen up?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Let me pull it up.
Okay. I'll just. So just so you can see, I've got a little bit of scripting in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, just because it bears mentioning, like, you don't need to write Gig Performer script for most things. This was the fear in answering this question. No, actually, most of this is still completely accessible in Gig Performer. And I think that's important to mention. So, like, just because you can script something doesn't mean the feature is unavailable within Gig Performer. Actually, Gig Performer has been designed so that you can use it no matter whether you can script or not. So you don't have to know it. You don't need to use it ever. And you can access a lot of these features. I would say 99% of what Bruce is doing can be done without scripting. But like he mentioned, at the time, it either wasn't available or he didn't know about it. So this is, Gig Performer is kind of... Trey Gunn, who came on with us, kind of said Gig Performer is very transparent. And I like that because sometimes there's more than one way to go about things. So I think we had to answer the question just in terms of why is Bruce doing this? But, it is, most things are still accessible without scripting. It's in there. So don't go down the rabbit hole unless you can't figure it out any other way would be my two cents on that. But yeah, so scripting, I appreciate that definition, Bruce. Was there anything else you wanted to show us just in terms of your setup, your design? And by the way, if you're watching right now and you've got some like value out of this, you like what you're seeing from Bruce, make sure you hit that like button. And Bruce, where can people check you out? I know maybe you, I don't know if you have another thing to show, but like people want to know more about the Fringe Benefit Band. What do they do? How do they go find you?
So it's thefringebenefitsband.com. It's a plural, benefits.
Yep.
Yeah. So okay. Yeah, thefringebenefitsband.com. And we're on Facebook, Fringe Benefits Band. So but we have a lot, nice little demo video. We did at a club down in Fredericksburg, Virginia that has incredible lighting. We didn't use our lighting on that.
The lights in that video are very impressive.
That place, I can't, we're going back in a few weeks. I'm going to shoot more video because they just have the best. I mean, we played casinos and places like they don't have lighting like these guys got.
Yep. Yep. Was there any other part of your rig that you wanted to show us through that you didn't want to miss? Go ahead, Bruce.
So there's one other thing. With the Living Guitar Wing, it's a big deal for a lot of people to use. In fact, the inventor of it uses it mostly as kind of a drum pad. And so I do almost none of that. The only one, so because that's a big deal within the, the Living Guitar community, mm-hmm. I just wanted to show you that I've used this button right here on one song for that sound. That's it. Other than that, it's just control. Just
did you have to
Gig Performer so it can make everything happen.
Did you have to do any crazy anything inside the Livid software to make it play nice with Gig Performer? Like, does it send strange messages, or is it straight CC messages, or what's coming out?
Yeah, you can make it do CC messages that you want. So, yeah.
Yep. All right, we got a question coming in from Dan. Are you really running the whole show using the techniques you talked about today?
Well, in terms of what I'm doing, yeah. I mean, that's, this happens to be my backup computer instead of the one that I'll be using on Saturday, but it's, I'm using the same gig file that I used 2 weeks ago. So,
And then this is, oh no, that's not the one. This is Glenn said, I want question one, want to sync my descriptions of my Nectar Pacer. Could I run one instance of Gig Performer 4 on one PC and a second instance on a second PC and then sync them or control one from the other via MIDI or something? I'm not familiar with the Nectar Pacer. Nebojia, do you want to pop on and answer that one? All right, we're going to pull Nebojia in for this. How's it going there, Nebojia?
Hey, good. I'm enjoying the show. This is amazing. This is just amazing stuff.
It's cool stuff, yeah.
Yeah, while you were talking, I had to pull in the MIDI guitar thingy for myself. So I was like...
Yes.
Yeah. So the question was, I think, if I get it right,
You
have two PCs that are both running GP4 and you want to sync them together or control one another. So there are several ways to do that. If you just want to sync start stop of some playback and tempo, then I would recommend using Ableton Link that's built into Gig Performer if they're on the same network. That just works. It will work with various applications and devices. If you want to use MIDI and control it, sure, you just have to have a MIDI device in both and send MIDI from one to the other. Third way is if they're on the same network, you can use OSC that's built into Gig Performer. Then you can do all kinds of crazy stuff, whatever you want. You can move widgets. You can, you can do that with MIDI as well. But so basically, there's many ways to control or sync two or more Gig Performers and other applications together, as long as they're on the same network or they're hooked up by a MIDI somehow.
Yes.
Does that answer Glenn's question?
I think so. And this is a follow-up, but I'm wondering if you answered it already. Could I interface the working via a door or a Windows project? But I guess it...
I'm not sure I understand that.
Yeah, I'm not sure I do either. But I want to put a video on our front. And, well, here's one more. Want to put a video monitor in front of it to show button state.
Sure.
Out of mono on PC to do this. I guess that's possible, right? I mean, sure. I don't really know how I'd go about doing that exactly, but.
So can I chime in on this?
Please.
So I think he's talking about just being able to see the screen and not be at the computer.
Gotcha.
And so, when I used to use the computer and there wasn't space on stage to put it behind the speaker on my left and I couldn't see it, you know, I wound up kind of putting it behind me and, you know, they told me that I shouldn't be showing my butt to the audience. So I got an iPad and I use a program called Remotix from the iPad that shows the screen. And an added benefit of that is with Gig Performer, if you want to change something, you can just point and click, with your finger. Whereas if it's on a computer, I got to shake the mouse and see where the cursor is.
Also, you can also do this, one of these. This is Touch OSC on an iPhone, but you can have them for iPad or anything like that. You can put it on the floor. You can keep it in your pocket if you want. This not only shows the button state, this actually controls things. So you can hook it up and control your Gig Performer with it if you wanted to. Or it could just be serving you as a display. I use it sometimes when I'm rehearsing in a chair over there and I'm away from my computer. I use it to switch patches and then tune my guitar because it can show the tuner too on this.
And Nebojia, there is a template, right, for that?
Yes, there's OSC templates for various OSC applications out there.
And people can find that on the Gig Performer Forum? Is that where it is?
Yes, Gig Performer Forum, and they're on our website, the templates.
Perfect. Bruce, what were you saying there?
Well, I'm just going to say, I guess you got to set up the OSC because I'm just using MIDI and GP script calls. I'm not, OSC is something I'd like to get into because, I would like to be able to control the MR18 mixer with OSC and I need to be able to read the levels of the vocals and then give them a boost when somebody comes in, with their lead vocal, like within a song part. That would be a really cool thing to do, but
it's an upcoming show for sure, because OSC keeps coming up. We kept trying to wait on it because it can be intimidating. But Bruce, did I cut you off? Was there one other thing you wanted to show, or did we get through everything?
No, there's one other thing. So
let's do it. Let's do it.
I don't know if it'll work, but let's see. It's a. So that's a pipe organ, and then for the pipe organ,
darkness falls across the land. The midnight hour is close at hand.
So
wait. Can you show us that rack? What have you done there?
Yeah,
that's very cool.
So it's seasonal, right? So
it is. Yeah.
So it's just the for Thriller.
Yeah.
And look, I want to apologize for my play. I haven't played anything correctly because
this is great.
But here's the rack space, and the key is this audio file player.
Mm-hmm.
This is the one that comes with Gig Performer. And so I got Vincent Price up here. And so this is, I've got, the play. Actually, if we go back to the front, you can see I've got buttons for audio file player. And then I've got, this is start and stop and
darkness.
Start from the beginning. Anyway.
And do you have that set up within the song parts you said?
Yeah. So when we're playing Thriller, this is just showing the panel now, but in the set list, the beginning of the song, I'm playing, a micro smooth lead sound. It's a synth sound. But then when we get to that part, I go to the pipe organ, and that's where that comes in. Now on a smooth micro, when you get to the end of the song, you got so happy Halloween.
So is that on a timer, or you have a note triggering that? Because it didn't switch immediately to my eyes when you moved to the micro smooth.
Oh yeah, so no, it switches immediately.
Gotcha.
That's the micro smooth is that sound.
Yes.
But it also, that rack space has the audio file player with the laugh on it.
Gotcha.
So that's where we get to the end of the song. I key the laugh with a button on the living. I'm sending MIDI from the guitar with this button that triggers the file player in that Gig Performer rack space.
Yes, that's what I was asking. So you're using a switch on your thing to get that to turn on there.
Yep.
Awesome. Well, friends, we're getting close to wrapping things here, but I want to make sure you get your questions answered from Bruce, because this was packed with info.
Right there.
Yeah. There you go. That's exactly right. So if you have if you have any questions for Bruce, pop them in there, and we were happy to answer them. Bruce, thanks so much for being here. I also wanted to mention David said that he was not available because of his show. So we've got two different links in the comments right now. One of them is the show that David is playing with his cover band. So I've placed that in there. The other link is the link to Bruce's website for his cover band. So if you guys want to see him use this live, I'm assuming you take bookings, right, Bruce? If you guys want to book Bruce's band, this is like, and look, do that.
Let me just say, shout out to my, bandmates.
Yes.
We got Eddie Ansueto earned a gold record with Salt and Pepper playing drums. So we got Vinnie Roth, his guitar album has been reviewed in all the major magazines. He's a great guitar player. And then, TJ Medina on bass is a very talented, played all over the world. And then Juliana is the voice that, everybody wants to join the band because of that,
Yes. Yeah. She is incredible. Friends, if you're watching and you haven't listened to any of their stuff, go listen, go listen to what they're doing, 'cause it's very cool. And hopefully it'll inspire you to kind of step up what you're doing. Like, 'cause as you can see from what Bruce is doing here, like possibilities, there are a lot of them. There are a lot of possibilities. Glenn is just saying thanks. Thanks for a great show. Bruce, thank you. Bob, awesome show. And yeah, so thank you so much. It looks like we've gotten through all of the questions here. So again, make sure you check out the Fringe Benefits Band. Make sure if you are around, you want to check out David's show this Friday. That's tomorrow. There's still tickets available at that link that we left in the chat. And Bruce, thank you so much. One more thing.
No, there's your outro.
We can't end it with anything better than that. Friends, we'll be back next week with another episode of Gig Performer Through the Genres. Thanks so much for being